Welcome to the introductory video on setting up a job in Print3D. While Print3D can do a lot of things, especially because it's integrated within the Inspire platform, we'll concentrate only on the Print3D part of it today to understand how to set up a quick model. This was obviously generated and we can import any geometry. You can simulate, however, by bringing in STLs, but in this demo, we're just going to see how to use Print3D with geometry and create support structure in, and do an analysis quickly. Just like every other tool in Inspire, it follows through all the icons on the top that guide the user to a process. And the first thing that you see here is print part. So the user interface is asking the end user to define what exactly is a part. So obviously, I click on this icon and click on this part. And then say, this is my define, that this is my material. And I can choose a bunch of different materials for this. And in this case, I'm going to use titanium. And you can also see what the material properties are. There's general material properties, there's thermal, and there's also mechanical. So with that, I'm just going to go very quickly. I've defined this part. And once you've defined this part and identified the material, I just click on the next icon, which is the printer. And in this case, I can define a default printer which just creates a box around it, or you can choose a few printers that are available like EOS, Renishon, SLM, which basically brings in the appropriate bed size for those printers. But in this case, I'm just going to use a default just to keep the demo short and quick. And then I just click on OK, and then it creates a very quick box around it, and that's your print box, and that's your part. The next step, obviously, and as you can see, is the orientation. I click on the part, and it automatically identifies areas that need support structure, which is basically highlighted in this yellow. So right now, I'm just going to click on this part and then attach it because it's about 5 millimeters away from the bed. So if I put 0 millimeters here, it goes and attaches itself to the bed. And that's what I'm going to do right now. I'll show you some other things you can do with this as well. You can also rotate the part and so on, but we'll come to that later. So right now I'm just attached this part, and next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to create a support structure. So I just click on this icon, and it takes a few seconds, a few minutes, sometimes if the part is large, to identify what those areas are, and then it automatically creates a block supports. And in this particular case, I can run the simulation with a block support. So that's what I'm going to do, because I want to do it very quickly. I want to understand what this part entails. So, and I can also slice this data and then look at how this looks in the top view. I can click on top view here, and I can move the slider, and you can see how the buildup is going to be because we're using block supports. You're seeing those as blocks. So now I go to my next tier. If I want to export this as an SLM, you can basically have STL parts, one for the part and one for the support, and export it as well. In this case, that's not my interest. I want to basically run a simulation on it and understand how this part behaves. So I'll just go to the analyze button here and I click on it. And here, very quickly, it tells me that, hey, this is whether you want to, it asks the user whether you want a thermomechanical simulation. What's the velocity of the laser? What's the laser power? What's the powder layer thickness? What's the absorption powder, the powder absorption? That is, if I put 250 watts, how much percentage is actually going into the material? So in this case, we're defining at 10%. This is a default values, and we recommend that you don't change them. The only thing you might want to change is sometimes the wattage, and that is dependent on the material. And also the cooling time and the base temperature of the plate. And if you want to have it elevated, you can also do it at an elevated temperature as well. And as soon as you bring this part in, it also looks at the part and gives you an average thickness that you want to use. So in this case, it tells me that the average thickness is 2 millimeters on the part, and it has automatically assigned a length of 0.71. But if I want to change that, I can go in and change that to, let's say, 1 millimeter. That's what I usually start my analysis on 1 millimeter, and then I just hit run. That's it. That's as simple as it gets, and it starts running the job right off the bat. And you can also do one thing: when it starts running the job, you can query the exact state by clicking on once it starts setting up the Solver deck, and then it runs basically a few stages all in one shot. That is, it's first doing the printing stage, then it does the cooling stage. That is, after it's printed between each layer, it's also doing the cooling. But after the entire part is done, it also does a cooling simulation where it does it cools that part down, and after it cools it down, it extracts the support, that it removes the support and does a spring back as well. So all of them are contained here. So as you can see, this is in real time. It is already finished 43%. So if I double click here, it'll update the geometry and show me how far the simulation is already done. Okay, so this is how much it has been done already. I'll let it run, but I'll show you another screen where I actually ran this job already, because the previous one is already 43% run. But this is a completed run, which takes about 5 or 6 minutes on 4 CPU laptop machine that I have. And the product also scales very, very well. So in this case, I've already run the simulation. So, and you can see that the first thing you can look at is the displacement. And if you don't like this kind of contour type, you can also change the contour type to a rainbow type, but we'll come to that in a second. So right now, all the stages are combined in this analysis. So you're seeing the print buildup, the printing, the cooling, as well as spring back. So if I basically cycle through this and I go to the last stage, which is where it is stopped at the end, I can use these arrows here to go back. So you could see the last stage was a spring back. And you could also see that there is no support structure in the last stage because that was removed. So I'm going backwards. So now you see that was the end of cooling. So that at the end of cooling, this is how it looked like. So if I look at the temperature, you can look at the temperature at the end of cooling. And that is, you know, you can also look at displacement. You can look at the total magnitude. You can also look at the X value displacement, or the Y value displacement, or the Z value displacement. So you can see all of them. And then you can also look at plastic strains. You can look at von Mises stresses. You can look at the nodal temperature or the average temperature of the elements. Am I in this button? And right now you can see that it's showing me that it's in Kelvin, and it's at the end of cooling. That's why the temperature is a little lower. And when you go back to displacement and then look at the total magnitude and then cycle through, and you can see that the legs here kind of expand. If I zoom in this, you could see that, and it goes spring back. I go to the next stage, you could see how much it's springing back. So very quickly, I can recycle this through. This is the build process. I'm using 1 millimeter element size here, so the analysis runs really fast. And that's what I would recommend. If you want to do a little better, you could probably do 0.75 or so, but I wouldn't run less than that. So that's what it is. And in the preference file, if you don't like this contour type, you can also go to the preferences here, and under print 3D and the analysis, you can change this from divergent to rainbow color. If some people like that, you can also look at the rainbow color and you can see pretty much the same thing. This is a quick demo on how to basically set up the job and run a print 3D simulation. But let's go back to the other session there where we had it, and it's still running in this case, but I'll just go back here and then show you how to edit the support structure in case you want to put some pins and other things, features that we have in the support structure. First of all, I can come into my support structure and I can click on any support structure, and I say, look, I want pin type of a support that puts in some spins, and I can give let's say 2 millimeters, and the sizing is 1 millimeter, and then it basically puts in support structure right there. You could see that, or I could say, look, I want spacing to be 1 millimeter and the size to be something smaller. Then you could also do that, and you could see that now it's put a lot more supports. And you can also say that I want a different kind of support somewhere else. For example, you want to create a different kind of support, and right here I can click on the support and then I say, look, I want a square support there. So you can see that's a square support. And you can also define whether you want a weak support so that you can extract it, or if you want a stronger support because you want to extract the heat. So depending on what you want to do with the support, if you want to extract heat or if you want to remove the support easily physically after it's printed, then you can do a weak support. So depending on what exactly you want, the overlap with the surface changes when you change it to a weak or a medium or a very strong connection. You could see where a strong connection has a deeper connection with the part. And a couple of other things that you can do with support structures also is, for example, you don't want to have a support like this. You can click on the support structure and then say, I want to split the support, partition the support, and it projects the support base at the bottom. So I could just go ahead and split the support by clicking 2 points. And then say yes, right click, and then the button pops up, and then it splits the support. And now it split the support, so I can click on this one support and then say I want to move this guy out. So you could see that it has moved that support out. Okay, I put it in the wrong direction, so I'll put it here. Then I like this support, then I click on the next support and I want to move that guy outside. So you can do this, and then come back and then say, look, I want to change the support to a square pin or a square pin like that. And you can do the same thing for here. If you want a square pin, you can do that as well. So there's things that you can do with a support structure all within one single environment. And you can do the same thing here. But in this case, I'm going to create a honeycomb kind of a and I would say make it 1 millimeter because I think the sizes that I define are very small. And you can also change the window size if you want, you know, to increase the window size or decrease the window size. And the beauty of our solution is that you can export this entire stuff. As I told you earlier, you can export the entire stuff as a geometry and take it to your any of the printers that you have to use their native support. So now I'm just going to go ahead and save this file for a second. Give it some name and save it. And then you could also see that the simulation that I just submitted is already finished. I click on it and you could see that it is already finished the previous simulation. But I go back now. I want to say, hey, look, I want to run it with this support structure. I can just hit run again. And so now the second job is being submitted now, where I have created the support. I didn't use a block support, but I just ran it with the supports that I have created. So even when we run the simulation, what we do is we take into consideration the type of supports that you have used and appropriately you'll still see the block support in your simulation, but we are appropriately grading the material properties so that it reflects you having to use these kind of supports that you're seeing on the screen.